This is Werner Palfinger, and I'm excited to present continuous remeshing for inverse rendering. This is a completely new method that can greatly speed up reconstruction of triangle meshes. I will give you an introduction, then explain the method, and finally share some evaluation results. We can forward render a 3D object to get RGB images, and we can also invert this operation to reconstruct the object from the images. We call this inverse rendering. There are multiple methods for inverse rendering. One quite new and powerful tool is differential rendering. Let's say we have an estimation of a triangle mesh, then we can forward render this estimation, compare the images with the ground truth, and backpropagate the image loss to update the mesh. The problem here is this sloppy partial derivative. We can easily calculate gradients of the vertices and backpropagate them to the vertices matrix, but the faces matrix has integer values and it's not clear how to update this. Let's see what happens if we only update the vertices and let the faces matrix be constant. As you can see, the vertices move in all directions and we get a catastrophic mesh quality. The standard solution to add a regularization term. Now we get much better results, but now we have a new problem. On the head and also on the hip, the triangles are quite large and we're not able to reconstruct more details. What people usually do here is to add classical remeshing after the optimization and then start the optimization again. We could also do that in a loop multiple times. Let's try that with our example. We're starting now with larger triangles. And as you can see, now the refinement is applied. And now again, you can see right after the remeshing, the mesh quality is high, but then the vertices again move away from each other. So we still have not a perfect mesh quality. The bigger problem is that the hind legs are still not reconstructed. This is because we decrease the triangle size too fast, so we would need to tune the parameters for this specific object. The third disadvantage is that the remeshing of large triangle meshes with the standard methods is just too slow, it takes many seconds. So I tried to find a more sophisticated solution. In this paper, the authors found a way to make the faces matrix differentiable. Unfortunately, this method is by far too slow for our problem. In this paper, the gradients are smoothed, which gives a really good mesh quality. Unfortunately, the results are much too smooth for our application. So I had to find a new method. It turned out that three key features were important. First of all, we need adaptive triangle size. Large triangles can be moved at high velocity and small triangles are necessary to reconstruct fine details. The second key feature is continuous remeshing. We apply continuous update to the triangulation and add and remove vertices to keep a good mesh quality. And the third key feature is scale invariance. It means that our method should work for very small and very large triangles efficiently at the same time. Of course, improving the mesh quality is also beneficial for increasing the velocity. Before we dive into the details of our method, I will show you how it performs on the previous example. Again, we start with large triangles, and now you can see the vertex count is continuously increased. So this is a continuous remeshing. Now I stopped after 2 seconds, and now you can see the adaptive triangle size. Triangle size is color-coded. The red regions here and here have large triangles that can move fast and explore new regions. The blue regions here have very small triangles that already are able to reconstruct fine details at the same time. When I continue and stop again after 3 seconds, you can see that there are two ribs missing. This is because they are not connected to the spine, they are incomplete. And the museum mounted them with a quite thin wire. Our method is even able to reconstruct this wire. And when the mesh reaches the missing ribs, the triangle size is increased again and the ribs are quickly reconstructed. So how does that work? You remember the first key feature was adaptive triangle size. So how do we get this triangle size? We start the optimization with large triangles and large vertex speed. And as the Adam optimizer decreases the vertex speed, we should decrease somehow also the triangle size. This linear behavior is a direct consequence of the scale invariance that we want to achieve. So my idea was, could we take the vertex speed from the atom optimizer and calculate the triangle size. Turned out, no, it's not that easy. This is why the atom optimizer has this well-known update rule with the first and second order moments, and alpha is a constant, it's the step size, or often called learning rate. And alpha defines the size of a trust region around the vertices. We can trust that the vertices move only inside of these regions in one step. And when these regions are not overlapping, then we can trust that we don't get flipped triangles. I first made a minor change to this update rule to replace these cube regions by spheres. That can be easily done by using the Euclidean distance here in the second order moment. The bigger issue is this constant alpha here. Alpha is the size of the trust region, and it's a constant. So we have a constant trust region, but we have a variable triangle size. And the range is two orders of magnitude. So this is a really big issue. Atom is just not scale invariant. And the only way to fix that is to add L here and to modify the update rule to get a scale invariant atom optimizer. You will remember from the last slide that we wanted to calculate the triangle size based on the velocity. But now the opposite happened. The triangle size is an input to calculate the velocity. So we still need a solution to find the triangle size. Let's look at this fraction here. I didn't find any name for this fraction, so I call it relative velocity. This has an interesting property that the length of the relative velocity is usually smaller than one. That's not obvious from this equation, but we can transform the equation and write it as a function of a signal noise ratio. And then you can see for a very large signal noise ratio, the length of nu goes to 1. What does that mean for inverse rendering? If you want to reconstruct this shape and we start from a large sphere, then in the beginning, all gradients are pointing to the center. Then after one step of optimizing, we get this smaller sphere, and then this, and the gradients are always the same. That means that the signal noise ratio is infinity, and the relative velocity nu is always 1. So we don't have any information from the object yet. We are just too far away. Then finally, when we touch the surface, the relative velocity decreases. So we find that constant, or at least consistent, gradients lead to a relative velocity nu close to 1. This is because we may be far away from the surface. Actually, we don't know the distance, but it could be a good time to increase the triangle size or edge length. On the other hand, if nu is small, this is because we observe random gradients. That means we are on a stable point and we may be on the final surface. So that could be a good time to decrease the triangle size. As we have seen, nu is a quite good sensor to decide if our triangle size is too small or too large. The solution is to add a closed loop controller to update the triangle size using the relative velocity. That was a lot of theory. Here's a practical example. It's just a toy example with a one-dimensional mesh that is optimized. And you can see the red line, this is the relative velocity. And the controller tries to keep this velocity close to the dashed line here, which is just a parameter, in this case 0.3. The controller then modifies this reference length, the green dashed line. It wouldn't be a good idea to use that directly because it changes all the time. So we use a tolerance range around this green line. And when the actual edge length, the black line, leaves this tolerance range, then the actual remeshing happens. This was a very simple example. In the real 3D case, we do this calculation for each vertex, and then we have finally found our adaptive triangle size. Now we can do the actual remeshing. Apart from controlling a triangle size, the objectives are to heal flipped triangles or other defects, and to keep the mesh well triangulated. We use a standard split, collapse, and flip method for the remeshing. Remember the nested optimization loops that we had before? The idea is to combine both loops and have only one combined loop for optimizing the vertex positions and the remeshing. We have seen that classical remeshing can take seconds for large meshes, and the optimization iteration just takes milliseconds. So we need to greatly speed up the remeshing. First, the remeshing is an iterative method, so we can just take one iteration. That gives us a factor of 10. And then we can move everything to the GPU and do it in parallel. That gives us another factor of 100. It's also important that now, as we don't restart the optimizer, but we remesh inside of the optimizer, we need to update the internal state of the optimizer. You can read the details of the three remeshing steps in the paper. We split long edges, we collapse short edges, we also collapse suspicious triangles, and we flip triangles to improve the triangulation quality. The first method, split, can easily be parallelized without interference. For the two other steps, we need to be careful to avoid topology changes. You can see here in this benchmark that our method needs 6 to 7 milliseconds for small meshes, and then it grows linearly with respect to vertex count for large meshes. This is now our complete update rule. We have the modified Atom optimizer, then the closed loop controller, and finally the actual remeshing. So here are some evaluation results. First, I used 5 basic standard objects, and I compared our method to the 2 baseline methods that we have seen in the introduction. To make it challenging, I used only 3 seconds of optimization. This is a video of the comparison, and you can see after 1 second, the baseline methods are working on large triangles, and at the same time, our method already uses small triangles to add fine details. Next, I added the more interesting complex objects, and I used the same default parameters for all 3 methods. The 2 baseline methods completely failed to reconstruct these objects, and with our method, we get useful results even after only 3 seconds. This is a video of the deer object. As you can see, the adaptive remeshing of our method finds good triangle size for reconstructing the antlers quickly. And the baseline method, even after 50 seconds of optimization, are not able to completely reconstruct the model. Then I made a final test. I used the Atom optimizer with remeshing, and I tuned it for the 2 complex objects. That gave much better results for the Smilodon object, but at the same time worse results for the 5 basic meshes. Simply, as you can see here, that the complex tuned Atom with remeshing method uses much larger triangles. So here again, on the right-hand side, our method with fine details and a complete reconstruction, almost complete. The Atom with remeshing with default parameters have also small triangles, but the hind legs are completely missing. And the Atom with remeshing and complex tuning can reconstruct the hind legs, but uses very large triangles and misses fine details. Here you can see the comparison in more detail. The first column, this is the numbers that we have seen in the overview, the root mean square distance. Lower values are of course better. In the second column, you can see the mean edge length of the triangle mesh, and the green line, which is again our method, are much smoother. This is because we continuously decrease the edge length. And the third column is very interesting. This is the flip ratio. It's the relative number of suspicious triangles with wrong normal vectors that goes to 0 quickly for the 2 simple objects, and also for the 2 complex objects, it is better than the baseline methods by an order of magnitude. A very brief outlook to the future. We are already working on adding textures and vertex colors to be able to use the method for physically based inverse rendering. And then of course it would be interesting to be able to handle self-intersection or to apply topology changes when needed. Thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to answer your questions.